Experimental Mathematics Seminar. Today's speaker is Dr. Ein-Ya, who will speak about this masterpiece, Insight into Game Theory. It's my favorite book. I recommend to everybody, and Ein-Ya will talk about it. As usual, anybody who would like to join us for dinner is welcome, but they have to let me know. The usual place, Evelyn, at 6:45 in the office. So let me know right after the talk whether you can make it. And one more announcement, everybody is welcome, but the seminar rules absolutely prohibit the use of laptops or smartphones or any other.
I say a few words just before I'm starting, then we have the slides, which will make me, for me, easier. My English, please, I'm apologize about my English. You know, I came to the idea of game theory, or to write a book in game theory, from the point of view of a mathematics teacher at the high school. And as if I felt that there is something in the teaching of mathematics in high school that is so technical and so boring that we are losing many of the students. From the, not the, you know, not the bright one, because the bright one, it doesn't matter if there is a teacher or not, or if there is a book or not, but still, we have in Israel a very strong group in game theory, mainly because of Professor Oman, who is a Nobel laureate in game theory. And he is strong enough and a very strong mathematician too, that the whole group of surrounding him is a very good one. And even here in the States, there are some of his students. And you know, in the community of game theory, there is a joke that says, if you want really to know game theory, it's better that you start studying Hebrew, because mainly the Israeli group of game theory is very big and very strong. So I came, and I'm not a game theorist proper, you know, I am not a proper researcher, but I came from the point of view of the teaching of mathematics and the teaching of game theory. So I came to it. The starting point was a book in Hebrew, and we thought and we hoped that it will go into the system, on the high school system. But as you can imagine, it didn't. We don't have enough teachers that are in the system to go into the system. I don't know exactly how it is here, but in the high schools it's very, very difficult. I tried, you know, I made some kind of a workshop with teachers, but it was really nothing. And then there is someone at the Stern Business School at NYU, that he is an Israeli and he's there, and he knew the book in Hebrew. And he said, look, there are many students who are coming for the first degree, even the business school, or sometimes even economy, that they are not oriented so much and not strong enough in mathematics, and they don't know anything about game theory. And you need to get some. So idea was, we have to try to translate the book into English. And we took the mission, and it was translated into English, and was published by a very good publisher, Cambridge University Press. And since then, it was 2 years ago, or a little bit less, it was translated to Russian too. So there is, if someone is reading and speaking Russian, there is, I have a copy, but I don't know where. We found someone, some of the guys from the center told me, you have to find someone who speaks English, speaks Russian, and knows game theory. Otherwise, it will not be even not similar to your book. Because he said he once was in Moscow and gave a lecture, so he was talking 5 minutes and the translator was talking 15 minutes, so he said, I don't know what he said. So we found a guy that is coming to Israel. We have at the advanced Institute of Advanced Study, they have every year an economics, school, summer school, and he's coming, so he knows English, he knows game theory, and he knows Russian, so he helped us with the Russian. He went through it, and it was very nice of him. So in the meantime, I tried to Chinese, but there is no one really interested. Some editor told me that he's very interested, but then he said, well, not now. Anyway, so the name of, so I wrote a book, and the book is a course, like a base for a course in game theory. To the level of high school it can be, and the level of college or whatever for students. So the
For everyone, even for, I enjoyed it.
For anyone.
And
yeah.
For even professional tradition, we're not expert.
Yeah, it is. And the name of the book is Insights into Game Theory, because it's not a proper textbook, a classical textbook in game theory. It's like to get a kind of a sense what is game theory, what game theory is. So here I am trying to.
Push twice because you have a blank page.
Twice?
Remember?
At the middle.
At the right one.
The right one.
Yeah.
Okay. A few branches of mathematics have been more influential in the social sciences than game theory. In recent years, it has become an essential tool for all social scientists studying the strategic behavior of competing individuals, firms, and companies. However, the mathematical complexity of game theory is often very intimidating for students who have only a basic understanding of mathematics. Here is offered a course in game theory which addresses this problem by providing students with an understanding of the key concepts and ideas of game theory without using formal mathematical notation. That was the main idea for me, to make as minimum that I could the formal language. So the course investigates four areas of game theory by using four different topics. By the way, everyone is a Nobel laureate. The first one, the college admission, it's a paper that was published, I think, in 1953. That is called the marriage, stable marriage and college admission by Gale and Shapley. Shapley is a Nobel laureate in game theory. David Gale passed away before, so he didn't get any. And the other thing is social justice and majority voting, which the Nobel laureate here is Kenneth Arrow from Princeton. Coalitions and cooperative games, it's again Shapley value, so it's Shapley who is a Nobel laureate. And a bankruptcy problem from the Talmud. The Talmud is a Jewish ancient that 2,000 years ago was written by the Jewish, scholars or whatever, and it's also a kind of a Nobel laureate because it's a paper written by Professor Oman, who is a Nobel laureate in 2005. In the 21st century, game theory stands in the front of the interdisciplinary research, and yet the high school's mathematics curriculum ignores completely this branch of mathematics. game theory undertakes to build mathematical models and draw conclusions from these models in connection with an interactive decision-making situation in which a group of people not necessarily sharing the same interest are required to make a decision. Mathematical modeling is the essence of the teaching of mathematics. The problem is that most of the mathematics taught at school has no connection to real life situations, and therefore the mathematical modeling is quite meaningless. Game theory is a branch of mathematics that is motivated mostly by the social sciences, or better, by human behavior, and therefore constructing mathematical models for real life situations is natural to the theory. In game theory, one can ensure that the students are able to understand the basic problem on which they are working. Our main goal was to make mathematics a subject that can be discussed and thought about through a basic comprehension of the problem at hand. So it will be an outline of the course, but I would like to say that it was written something about the interdisciplinary of the game theory. I'm coming from the center of rationality at the Hebrew University, which is unique in the world. What is very special in it is the core of the center is the mathematician, the game theorist. But around them, there are people from the law school, economics, biology, ecology, psychology, philosophy, you name it. So it's proper interdisciplinary, and there are many papers that are written in the center because of, you know, common work between the members of the center. So that's the outline of the course. The course follows the book Insight into Game Theory and Alternative Mathematical Experience, written by late Michael Maschler and by myself, published by Cambridge University Press in 2008. The choice of the topics reflects our purpose. We wanted to present material that does not require mathematical prerequisites, and yet involves deep game theoretic ideas and some mathematical sophistication. Broadly speaking, the topics are all related to the various meanings that can be given to the concept of fair division. The course is a collection of few topics from the theory that are intended to open a window onto new and fascinating world of mathematical application to the social sciences. It selects a small number of topics and studies them in depth. It shows the student how mathematical model can be constructed for real life issues. One of the aims of the course is to acquaint the students with a different mathematics, a mathematics that is not buried under complicated formulas, yet contains deep mathematical thinking. Another aim is to show that mathematics can efficiently end social issues. The third aim is to deepen the mathematical thinking of the person who studies this book. We believe that by studying the topics of the book, the mathematical thinking of the student will be enriched. The book on which the course is based is divided into chapters that are independent so that the teacher and the student can choose one chapter or several and cover them in any order. The first chapter, Mathematical Matching, concerns, among other things, the problem of assigning applicants to institutions of higher learning. Each applicant ranks the universities in which he is applying according to his scale of preferences. The universities in turn rank the applicants for admission according to their own scale of preferences. The question is how to affect the matching between the applicants and the universities. The problem leads to unexpected solutions. I would like also to make a remark here that there was a paper that was written by David Gale that he wrote that in 1960, I think, in the New Yorker, there was something written about the problems of admission to Yale University. So it was, you know, in the paper, it was spread how it's complicated and how it's tough for the admission office to get the student, you know, according their preferences or whatever. And they were working, Gale and Chapley at the Rand Institute then, and they decided that they would try to find the kind of a solution that will start with a stable matching. Now it's called I called it mathematical matching, but you know, they called it the marriage problem, the marriage table problem, and because it happened to be, they started talking about schools and students, but then to make it easier for the proof and for the, you know, the everything that, you know, all definitions that we need, everything, it will be easier if the situation will be N student with N schools, which is very artificial, of course, means one student to one school. So what was going to be more similar to it is women and men, you know, matching women and men, and it will be one to one.
But that was in the old days. Well, yeah. Men marry women.
Yeah. But you know, that's now you can say everything. Still, you can say group A and group B. It's supposed to be groups, you know. Otherwise, it's not. And they proved how, which is really very surprising, that there is always stable matching, which is not, you know, the proof is very, very easy, and the situation is, it is surprising, because any preference that you are writing for men and for women, and you are taking the all, even though at the beginning they made a kind of supposition, you know, kind of that there will be no indifference and just one to one and just the same number. It's needed for the proof, but then you can generalize the problem. And it comes that even someone says, wait, well, I'm staying alone, I'm going with A, otherwise I'm alone. And it still works in every kind of situation, so which is very surprising. The second chapter, this is we called it social justice, concerns social decision rules. In a democratic society, it is customary to make decisions by a vote. The decisions supported by the majority of voters is adopted, as we know, in a formal society. But we show that majority rule does not always yield a clear-cut solution. The attempt to find other voting rules raises unexpected difficulties. So, to tell this paper is what was written by Kenneth Arrow. I'm thinking, I think it's in the 60s. And it's his theorem called the impossible theorem. So he took a kind of paradox, which called the Condorcet paradox, which is if you take a group of people and you write all the preference, the model of the paradox is three people with three issues, and then it comes if you are working with a majority rule that X is preferred on Y, is preferred on Z, is preferred on X, which is a circle that it cannot be. That means it's not in every situation the majority rule will give us a solution. So what Eros tried to do, he drew a set of five axioms, trying to find a kind of a solution that will fulfill the all five axioms. Let's say one of the main that I can say it's no dictatorship. And when you start looking for it and proving it, it says that every situation that you take, it will lead to a dictatorship. So it means that all five axioms are not fulfilled altogether. So that's the reason that he called it the impossible solution. So this is one of his, I think that even he got his Nobel Prize for this theorem. The third chapter, the Shapley value in cooperative games addresses, among other things, the following problem. A group of people come before an arbitrator and inform him of the expected profits of every subgroup, as well of the whole group, if the groups operate independently. It seems that this data are sufficient for the arbitrator to decide how to divide the profits if all litigants operate together. Now the Shapley value, you know, it's kind of, this is one of the solutions for cooperative games. What makes it interesting, very interesting, it's an only one solution. Because there are in-game theory, there are situations that you get more than one situation. Game theory, in a way, it's not a descriptive theory, it's a normative theory. So you can say that in this situation, you can do A, B, or C, and you can choose. The Shapley value is a kind of a one and only one solution. So if you take a group of people, and dividing, you know, the whole group to subgroups, and every subgroup gets a number of the worth of the subgroup. And what the Shapley value says, if the big coalition is constructed, they are going all of them together, he gave only one solution how to divide between all the members, the number, you know, the essence, the estate or whatever that they have together. So this is one of it, and we are showing it in many situations, in a way like a situation of making a cooperative stuff like working together or building things together, and suddenly they are deciding to you know, to split back, and so how they are dividing between themselves what they have together, and it is one solution. The first chapter, which is the analysis of a bankruptcy problem from the Talmud, addresses the following problem. Several creditors have claims to an estate, but the total amount of the claims exceeds the value of the estate. How should the estate be divided among creditors? In the chapter, several solutions are accepted, two of which are discussed in the Talmud. Now, in the Talmud, I'll show you, in the Talmud, there is a kind of a situation that there are three women married to one man, and he passed away. One woman was promised $400, whatever, dollars or whatever, if it's passing away. The other one, $2,000, it's a kind of a traktate. In Hebrew, it's called the ketubah between in a marriage, that the bride is saying that he will pay he will pay in case he's dying or whatever, what she wears for him, and $300. And the estate was, once it was $100, $200, and $300. So in case, if the estate is $100, so it's smaller, this very small amount, the Mishnah in the Talmud says they will split it equally, which makes sense in a way. Now, the Talmud says she will get 50 and they both will get 75, which altogether is 200. And here it will be 50, 100, and 150. Now, if you look at this column, it's, the estate is very small, so they are splitting equally. Here, it's divided proportionally, which makes sense also. You know, this is half of the of what she was promised, it is half of what, and this is half of what she was promised, and altogether, it's 300. This column has no explanation along the whole debates of the Talmud through the 2,000 years ago. There was nothing there was hints or whatever, but nothing was really an explanation for this. So Professor Oman and Michael Mashler, they took this situation and they translated it to a cooperative game, and they found that the old table is one of the solutions of cooperative games that is called the kernel. Now the kernel was created, I think, in the 1969 or 1970 by someone from Tel Aviv University. So probably the old Talmudic guys, they didn't know anything in game theory. After they found the solution in game theory, they stepped backward and tried to find the kind of a solution that will make sense adapted to the times of the Talmud, which was very, very, very nice. And they generalized it that the situation can be that the amount of the estate could be anything, and the number of the creditors can be also whatever it is, which brings something very surprising to the whole situation. So this chapter deals with the problem of the Talmud. Broadly speaking, all the chapters in the book represent attempts at reaching a decision in a conflict situation, and in each of them we show difficulties in trying to define a superior a solution. The third chapter on the matching presents a weak condition of stability, which nevertheless yields many matchings. One of them is the best for the man, and another is the best for the woman. There is nothing that we can offer which is the best for the whole, of both of them. There are situations that it comes, that it will be the same if we are making the, according to the the Gay-Shapley algorithm, it can be that both will get the same matching, and this is the only one. But it's not as it's not in general, so it cannot really be. The second chapter tries to reach a decision by voting, and we saw that the fair voting rule is not always possible, as I told you about a situation, the impossible theory. The third chapter has probably the most successful solution, which is the Shapley value. It provides a solution for an unbiased arbitrator by supplying axioms that seem fair. However, somewhat different axioms, not covered in this book, yield different solutions. So it's not every situation can be covered. Finally, the fourth chapter, which consider a case of the bankruptcy conflict, shows that even in this simple case, a superior solution cannot be found. In conclusion, we see that various solutions are well tailored to many real situations, but there is no single solution that fits all situations. Each solution sheds some light on reality. I would like to add something too, you know, a kind of a remark. I read a lot about it, and you know, when I was writing my PhD thesis, that the two, almost all the chapters, the social scientists were in a way upset about what game theory gave them. You know, they were sure that they are getting models, mathematical models, and then they can use them, and it will be, you know, a help to like in science. But and they were quite frustrated because game theory doesn't give a specific solution every time or everywhere, and sometimes it gives more than one solution. So it's, we have to say that's it.
Because human beings are much more complicated than particles.
Yeah, that's electrons. You know, in physics you can make better than in social sciences. So that's it. Thank you. Any questions or whatever?
Thank you very much. There is time for questions. So, was it ever adapted in the class?
Yeah, in a way, you know, I'm doing the, because I am a member of the Center for Rationality, we have two things. I'm running a kind of an experiment. It's a 6 year that we are doing it for high school kids in Jerusalem that are coming from high schools in the Jerusalem and Jerusalem area. And once a week, for almost a full academic year, we are starting when the academic year is starting, and we are finishing right now at Pesach,
For gifted students?
Yes, yes. They are coming for 3 hours, once a week. We are teaching them game theory. I'm not a teacher, I'm just in charge of it. The teacher at the beginning they started, he made it pro bono, one of the professors of computer science, you know, he came after his boss, Michael Shapira, and he was very keen to do it, you know, so 2 years he made it pro bono. And when he became very busy, his student, his PhD student in mathematics and computer science together, he's a teacher. And so they are studying basically, this is the core of the course, but we are adding, you know, stuff. It depends on the kids. It depends, we are adding some material. So, and they are getting lectures, you know, like enrichment lectures by members of the Center for Rationality. A lecture in law, the application of game theory to law, how it's the application to psychology, to economics. So once in a while, they are getting a kind of another thing that we have a kind of a program in the center that students can take a track of a master degree and PhD degree in rationality. But they have to come, they have to be registered as PhD or master student in one of the subjects that there are members in the center. Means you can be, you can come from law, from economics, from mathematics, from computer science or whatever. They have to be registered there and fulfill their duties there. And they have to take some specific courses in our center. And one of them is game theory. Now, what we found that the course in game theory was given by pure mathematicians, and it was, you know, rigid and hard. So the students from economics or law school or other social sciences or other humanities parts, you know, didn't, even they were bright in their subject, they didn't, they came to be a student in the rationality center. So there was, last year we started it, I took to do a course for them, which is light game theory, which is, you know, more based on my book, not very rigid mathematics, but kind of to open, you know, open the mind or whatever toward game theory, and then if they succeed or they want, they can take another one. But it is enough, and we decided that we are doing every 2 years. So last year I started, and next year I do it again. The basic is this, that I'm an expert to teach game theory for non-mathematicians. That's my expertise.
Yeah, so. I want to make a suggestion. This is such a beautiful book, but it deserves a part two, second sequel. So we could do next equilibrium and generalize.
You think so?
Please write another book.
For the non-cooperative games.
Yeah. So did you ever think of finding a sequel?
I'm thinking, you know, but you know, it's first I need Marshall. No, yeah. But you know, in a way, the reason that we made it for the cooperative game, starting with it, because it was meant to be in Hebrew for really for high school kids. And if you start with the strategic games, you have to be, you have to know a little bit of probability. And not all the students at the high school.
No, I'm not complaining why you didn't
do it here.
So that was another book.
Yeah. So maybe, so that's the reason that they skip the old Nash equilibrium and all the stuff.
Yeah.
But in the course that I'm teaching the students at the university, we are doing it too. You know, again, in a light mode or something, not very mathematical rigidity, but still we are doing it, yes.
That's next again. Anybody want to come?
This was hit nicely in my 103 course.
Oh, yeah, right. Oh yeah, maybe we should attend it.
Show it to my co-winder.
Oh yeah, we should show it to, I should attend it. It fits in one of the courses taught in this for non-mathematics majors?
I think that in general for non-mathematical majors, it can make a lot.
Yeah.
I'm always talking about, you know, a mathematics teacher, that I think that mathematics is important in schools because it's within the subject matter, it forces you to think, you know, to think logically, which you are not getting used to it when you are studying humanities or even social sciences. And mathematics is it. And you can do, with game theory, you can do something which is, as I'm saying, light, but still very impressive in one way, and very attractive in other way, and still it's do what it's needed to do with the mathematics of it. Because we don't, I don't give anything, there is nothing that is not true in mathematics or non-mathematics, still mathematics, but it's given in another way.
Thank you. If you like your class for dinner, I have decided to make it earlier than you.